Welcome to the 11th lecture in the series of on Riemann integration, and possibly this will be the last lecture of the series unless the viewers go through my set of notes and want some extra results. Okay, but these 11 lectures more or less constitutes what you could ever see in a chapter on Riemann integration, and with a lot of good exercise examples. Okay, so as I said in the last lecture, today we are going to talk about two very important examples of Riemann-Stieltjes integration. In fact, these are the, I would say, the most important. Okay, either from applications point of view in probability and statistics, or even in physics oriented things. Okay, so, and we are going to look at these two things today, and probably it should not take more than 40 minutes unless I get a stymied somewhere, right, which is always possible. Right, okay, so let us start sharing and do the work. Okay, so the first result we want to do is, let us recall, do you remember we defined what is meant by the Heaviside function? Okay, if AB is here and C is here, then I say HC or HT, okay, T. HT of X equal to 0 if X is less than T, equal to 1 if X is greater than or equal to T. Right? What did you prove? Then if F is a continuous function on AB to R, then integral, let alpha equal to H of T, and integral D alpha, okay, 0 to, sorry, A to B will exist and it's equal to F of T. Okay, this is already seen, right? Now we want to extend it. What do we want to do? What do we want to do? Extension. In what way I can extend? Take finitely many points T1 to TK. As always, we will assume T1 less than T2 less than TK, and A is less than or equal to T. Sorry, A is strictly less than T and less than or equal to B. Can you guess why A should be less strictly less than T1? I leave it to you to think about. Okay, TK. Right? And suppose C1 to CK are non-negative. Okay, all of them are non-negative. Right? Then let's look at alpha equal to summation CK. Okay, this is what CA, okay. Let me say CN, TN and CN. Because the moment you see N, you may think something to the partition, that's why I want to avoid. Okay, anyway, let us write CR, R equal to 1 to K of CK, H of TK, TK. Okay, it's clear alpha is increasing. Yeah, that's because my CKs are non-negative, right? CRs are all non-negative, yeah? Okay, therefore if F is a continuous function from AB to R, and if alpha is the integrator, which is an increasing function, I hope all of you can see that this is why it is increasing, right? You start with any X here, right? And Y, then if there is a TK, then it's going to be increased, otherwise they will be the same thing. If both are less than or equal to some TR, X and Y, then you can see. Yeah, right, anyway, just okay, check, it's easier instead of my saying. If you want, let's look at T1 and let's say T2, only two things. Now my X may be here, Y may be here, or X and Y may be here, or X and Y may both be here, or X is here, Y is here. These are the possibilities. Try to see whether you can see alpha X is always less than or equal to alpha Y. Okay, just to don't trust me, please check. Okay, As Buddha said, even if it is from your teacher, please check, okay, verify. If found to be true, then only accept. Don't accept just because I am your teacher. I am teaching. Okay. Anyway, then what do you think f of d alpha will be? It will be summation cr f of tr r running from 1 to k. How many have accepted why this is true? What theorem you are using? Remember, we proved if alpha and beta are integrators, then let's say lambda alpha plus mu beta is also an integrator, then we said f of d of lambda alpha plus mu beta was lambda f d alpha plus mu f d beta. You had already seen it. Okay, I proved it for alpha plus beta, but you may if you play through the record, the video, you will see that I also said you can multiply by this. Okay, because if alpha is an integrator, I can think of lambda alpha as an integrator. Okay, then lambda will come out. Okay, yeah. Are you following? So we had already proved it for any integrator, not necessarily increasing, but now we are in increasing situation. And why I wanted increasing? Because of the earlier result. Okay, because if it's increasing and the function is continuous, then I know integral fd alpha will be f at t, where alpha is the Heaviside function situated at t. Okay, are you happy? Are you sure? Okay, so this is the crucial thing. So what you have proved? If alpha is summation cr htr r equal to 1 to k and f is continuous on a b, then integral f d alpha exists and it's equal to cr f of tr r equal to 1 to k. Is this clear? Pause, review, proceed. Now I want to extend it still further. This was a finite sum. I want to extend it. So what do you think I want to say now? Can you guess? Let Tm be a sequence in the interval AB and Cn be a sequence of non-negative numbers. Then I want to define alpha equal to summation Cn Htn. Are you following? So that is the obvious thing I can make guess, right? So I am taking Tn, this is a sequence in AB, and I want a sequence Cn. What are the conditions? Cn must be non-negative, right? Then what is that I would like to define? Alpha I would like to define as Cn times Htn. You understand this? Right. So this is n equal to 1 to infinity or whatever it is. Okay, but remember, I want alpha. See, this is some of non-negative things, therefore alpha will be increasing. That's no problem. But alpha must be a function from AB to R. That is, it must be real valued. Okay, what does that mean? If I take alpha to B, what do you think I will get? I will get Cn and Htn at B. That will be 1. Yeah, therefore it will be summation Cn. But that must be real number. That means what? So I have to put, I cannot take arbitrary sequence Cn, non-negative sequence Cn, but I also have to assume this is convergent. Do you understand that? Do you see the reason why? Textbook will simply say take a sequence so that this happens, but you should know why I have to emphasize if I, okay. So what should be the theorem I want to prove? Make a guess. It may not be correct, but I can always, okay, be greedy. I can aim for better things. So what did I prove? If f is a continuous function from AB to R and alpha equal to summation R equal to 1 to k summation CR HTK. Then I proved indirectly FD alpha equal to summation CR FTR R running from 1 to k. So I want to generalize this. So what should be the natural thing? Yeah. So assume F is A, B to R continuous and Tn is a sequence in AB and Cn is a sequence which is non-negative, so that the associated series summation Cn is convergent. Okay, then define then alpha equal to summation Cn Htn n equal to 1 to infinity. This is a function from AB to R and it is an increasing function. This is easy. And this is the crucial operational part, F d alpha equal to, can somebody guess, into infinity Cn F of Tn. You see that this is exactly, we generalize the last finite sum result, that's it. The proof is also pretty easy, we will do that. Before that, let's try to understand. Notice that this in some sense, suppose my say, okay, this in some sense try to reduce, okay, our integral to a finite sum. Do you see that? This one reduces, a finite sum is a special case of an integral. Okay, let us put it that way. Okay, as we know intuitively, we always think of integral as a continuous sum, whatever it may mean. Okay, that's intuition. But it says even a finite sum is an integral, but it's not Riemann integral, it's a Riemann Stieltjes integral, properly defined, right? And what does this say? This seems to say that even an infinite series could be a special case of Riemann Stieltjes integral. Yeah, think about it. Okay, try to understand the statement of the theorem. Okay, many times people immediately jump to the proof, but you should appreciate the theorem. Yeah, right. It's like anyway, is it all right? Now I just want you to think about a very easy example. Suppose all of you know what is called greatest integer function, right? X going to greatest integer function from R to set of integers. What is that? X going to X. This is an integer m and the unique integer such that m is less than or equal to x, strictly less than m plus 1, right? All of you know that. If you have gone through my video lectures on real numbers, I had proved it, all right? Now, you restrict it to something like 0 to some any interval n or even a to b, I don't care, right? Now define alpha x to be the greatest integer function, yeah? Notice that this is going to be increasing function, right? Because 0 to 1, it will be 0, 1 to 2, okay? Here it will be 0, and here it will be 1, and so on, right? So this is an increasing function. Can you write alpha as a sum of, sum meaning linear sum, okay? Sum of Heaviside functions. So what are the points here? My Tn's tk, t1, t2, tk are going to be 1, 2, 3 up to n, or up to n minus 1, whatever it is, right? So essentially it's going to be something like f of n. Now you see, if I have a function f which from R to something, then I can define f of n and try to look at the sum, natural numbers. Yeah? Are you following? Don't worry too much about you. Do you get a glimpse that you are going to get even infinite series as a special case? That's all I wanted to say. Okay, think about, okay, if you do, just even if you understand about 30-40%, that's good enough. Okay, once you come across such a situation in future, then you will see, oh, that's what Professor Kumarisen said. Okay, right, anyway, this is what you want to prove now. What do you want to prove? I want to prove this result. Okay. So how do you think I will prove? First, let us make an idea clear. Yeah, what is the idea? So I want this integral. Okay, as usual, let us try to develop some kind of strategy. This is what I want to claim. Cn f of tn. Right? Okay, this is defined because f is continuous and alpha is increasing function. This makes sense. Okay? Now I have to know whether this makes sense. This also makes sense. Why this makes sense? Remove f is continuous, therefore mod f will be less than equal to some m, therefore modulus of this I can take will be m times this object will be m times cn, because mod cn is m is cn, and this is convergent, therefore this also is convergent. This is absolutely convergent and hence it is convergent. Are you happy? So this also makes sense. Very good. Next, what is the meaning of this sum? This sum by definition is limit of ck f of tk, k equal to 1 to n, limit over n. Right? Okay. Therefore, if I want to show this object equal to this, what does that mean? The limit of this fellow equal to this number. If I want to show the limit of this sequence, this, remember this is a sequence of numbers now. This sequence of numbers converges to this number. So what does it mean? You give me an epsilon, I have to find a capital N. So that after that, capital N, this finite sum minus this in modulus will be less than epsilon. You understand? So whenever you look at the such things, always go slow, try to understand what you want to prove and formulate it in your own words. Okay, then you will feel happy. You will be more confident. Right? So this suggests, but I know what this is. What is this? Ck f of tk. I know what this is. This is integral of f of, let us call it alpha k, okay, a to b, where alpha k is by definition alpha n. Let us say alpha n is by definition ck h of tk k equal to 1 to n. Do you understand this? Yeah, this is what we have seen just now, right? Okay, good. Yeah, now what do you think I should do? Yeah, now alpha is alpha k, let us write it as beta k. What is alpha n plus beta n? What is beta n? Beta n will be n plus 1 to infinity ck htk. Again notice that this makes sense. Okay, we had already seen it. Okay, this is increasing and this will be tail of the series, right? Summation ck. Do you understand how I proved this alpha makes sense? Right, so this is only part of the thing. Okay, by the same logic this also makes sense. In fact, if n is very large, this will be arbitrarily small. Okay, right. Now again, what do I know? Alpha n is increasing, beta n is increasing. Okay, therefore what do I know from early result? Do you see that just now I quoted, if sigma equal to alpha plus beta, then integral d f d sigma is integral f d alpha plus integral f d beta. We proved it, right? This is for any kind of integrator as long as f is integrable. You understand? Now f is continuous and these are all increasing, therefore integral f d alpha makes sense, integral f d alpha n makes sense, integral f d beta n makes sense. Do you understand this? All of them make sense. Okay, sure, right? And what is the relation between them? Because of this result, this is integral f d alpha equal to integral f d alpha n plus integral f d beta n. Remember, I should write limits of integration a to b, a to b, but I'm little too lazy, I don't want to write. But if you want to be careful with your teacher, you should write it, okay? Otherwise you may not get marks, okay? That you had understood well is not enough, but you should also be careful, right, in writing anyway. Right, okay. Now what is that I want to do? What did I want to show? This fellow is nothing other than summation ck f of tk k equal to 1 to n. So what did I want to show? As n goes to infinity, this fellow approaches this integral, integral f d alpha. For that what should I do? I want to show f d alpha minus this fellow 1 to n ck f tk. Okay, this in modulus goes to 0. This is what I wanted to check. Okay, this is same as saying I have to check integral f d alpha minus integral f d alpha n, which is equal to integral f d beta n, whether this goes to 0. Do you understand this? Because this is equal to this without modulus, of course. Yeah, okay. Now what is f d beta n? Oh, you want to write a to b, yeah, and I want that, so I'm just writing it. When I want to say this is less than 0, what I have to show? I have to estimate it in modulus, right? Now modulus of the integral, I'm sure now all of you know, what should I do? I use the basic integral inequality. What is the basic integral inequality? A to b mod f into d beta n. Remember, for our increasing function as integrators, we approved this result. Not only you proved this result, we are actually proved something much more. What is that? You have proved, remember, integral f d alpha, this is very general, nothing to do with this alpha or anything. We have proved less than or equal to integral mod f d alpha, and that in term is less than or equal to m, where m is the an upper bound for mod f, times alpha b minus alpha a. Do you remember this? Okay, in the list of properties of integral function, this is one of the things we proved, right? Therefore, this fellow, if assume that m, if is continuous, therefore mod f is bounded, let's say, by m, this is going to be less than or equal to m times bn minus b beta n minus beta a. You understood this? Now, what is beta n of a? Remember, my a, my t1, t2, tk, everything is going to be here, right? Therefore, my htk of a is always 0. Therefore, beta n of a is always 0. And my htk of b is always 1. Therefore, my htn of b is going to be n plus 1 to infinity of ck. Do you understand this? Yeah? I'm sure all of you know how to prove that. Notice that this is a, okay, m is a finite quantity. I have to say this goes to 0. But h, okay, not hcn, sorry. Hcn is c. I'm hurry, okay. What did I say? Beta n. So htn of b is always 1. Therefore, beta n of b is ck htk of b from n plus 1 to infinity. Therefore, it is ck n plus 1 to infinity. You understand that? That's what I meant. So beta n of b minus beta n of a is summation ck k running from n plus 1 to infinity. Okay, now are you ready with the epsilon delta definition? Now see, if I wanted to show this converges to integral f d alpha, give me an epsilon, I have to find there is an n capital N, such that for all n greater than capital N, what should I show? Integral f d alpha modulus integral a to b f d alpha minus 1 to n ck f t k is less than epsilon for all n greater than equal to n, right? But this we found out just now, this is nothing other than C K running from n plus 1 to infinity. So what I want is, this is less than epsilon. Can I do that? Because remember, our hypothesis summation CK 1 to infinity is convergent. Therefore, given epsilon positive, there exists n, so that for n greater than equal to n, the tail of the series n to infinity of CK is less than epsilon. Yeah? So we have proved the result. Now you should learn how to write a textbook proof. It will also be in my article if you want. Okay, pause, review and proceed. Okay, the second important example, this is the second important example, is this. Suppose f is a continuous function from a, b to r, and alpha from a, b to r is c1, that is continuously differentiable. Right? Okay. Then what do you want to prove? We want to show integral a to b f d alpha. It is, remember, it is only continuously differentiable. I am not putting any extra assumption. Okay? Right? So alpha is, looks like a general integrator, nothing like increasing or anything. This is ordinary integral a to b f alpha dash, that is at x, that is f of x into alpha dash x into dx. Okay, so we will simply write is a to b f alpha dash. Okay, notice that this makes sense because we are assuming f is continuous. Did I forget to say that? Anyway, f is, I said that but I forgot to write it. F is continuous and alpha is continuously differentiable, then the alpha integral of f is nothing other than ordinary Riemann integral of the function f times alpha dash. Why should it make sense? Remember, f is continuous, alpha dash is continuous, therefore product is continuous, and any continuous function is Riemann integrable. Therefore, this is a Riemann integral exist. This is a Riemann integral, right? Do you understand this? We want to prove that. Okay. Actually, something much more general result can be proved, okay, if you simply assume that alpha dash is integrable. Remember, I used the fact f is integral, alpha dash is integrable, therefore the product is integrable in the Riemann sense, okay, Riemann integral sense, right? But if I already know f is continuous, therefore f is integrable, alpha dash is integrable, we had already seen the product is Riemann integrable, therefore this makes sense. So in that case also one can prove, that's a little more involved analysis, but okay, for practical purpose this theorem is good enough for all practical uses. This theorem is good enough, but if you want a very general result also, it's just a little extra work, and I have done it in my set of notes, you can see that. And in case you don't understand, you can always put it in my comments. We will produce another video on that. Okay, but if you had gone through all these 10 lectures of mine, I'm sure you will be more confident about integration than I am. Yeah? So, anyway. Right. So, I want to prove that. Yeah? Now, let's try to understand. So, remember, what should be the approach I should take? Darboux approach or Riemann sum approach? Of course, Riemann sum approach, because I only said alpha is continuously differentiable, therefore alpha prime may or may not be increasing. You understand? So let us look at. So integral a to b f d alpha, the corresponding Riemann sum looks something like this. F of some ti and delta alpha I equal to 1 to n. Whereas this is the Riemann sum, yes, f p t alpha, right? So if epsilon is given, this will be epsilon close to that. Okay, there is a partition p, so that for every partition q which is finer than p, okay this will be epsilon close to this. Is that clear? Right, but let's try to understand what do we want here. But what will be the Riemann sum for this? The Riemann sum for this will look like this: f of ti and alpha prime ti into delta xi, which is fti alpha prime ti into xi minus 1. Am I right? For the same partition P, this is how it will look like. Yeah? But let us try to understand this Riemann sum for the alpha Riemann sum. This alpha Riemann sum, I can write it as f of ti into alpha xi minus alpha xi minus 1. I want you, all of you now have developed a fantastic sense of observation. Let us look at these two sums. Okay, a Riemann sum for f alpha dash looks like this. A Riemann sum for f d alpha looks like this. Okay, I want to say essentially they are very close to each other, so that these two intervals are the same, right? This is the intuition. Now let's look at this. There is something which should strike you. What should strike you? What should I do with the left, this side, this sum? Yes, you guessed it right. I have to use mean value theorem, apply mean value theorem to the function alpha on the interval xi minus 1 to xi. Yeah, I'm sure all of you got it right. Don't let me down. So this fellow I can write as summation f of ti into alpha dash at si, because I do not know it will be same ti. You understand this? Xi minus 1 to xi. Okay, this may be some ti, si, and ti may be something else. Okay, ti may be something else, need not be less than si, but I do not know where. Okay, so like that. Okay, you understand that? Times what? Times xi minus xi minus 1. Is it all right? Yeah. Okay, now what do you think I should do? Okay, so I hope all of you are following my logic, right? So I want to show, given an epsilon, there exists a partition P such that the Riemann sum for this partition is epsilon close to this integral. Right, but what I know is, given epsilon, there is a partition P so that for all q finer than P, this any kind of this Riemann sum is epsilon close to this integral. But this sum is same as this sum. You follow that? Yeah. So what is that I want to do? So I want to look at integral a to b f d alpha minus integral f of ti alpha dash ti into xi minus 1. I have to estimate. You understand that? This is again q any partition finer than this, and t is the same set of tags which I used here. Alright. So I want to say, look at the Riemann sum for f alpha dash with respect to this. So this will be, yes, f q t, yes, f alpha dash t q, yeah, that's it. This is a Riemann sum, right? This object is the Riemann sum of f alpha dash with respect to the partition q, with respect to the same set of tags t. You understand this? Yeah, so if I show for all q finer than p and for any set of tags t in q, if this fellow is something to do with epsilon, epsilon close to this, I am through. Are you following? Okay, but that's very easy. Why? Because now add and subtract. This is integral a to b f d alpha minus summation f of ti and alpha prime si into xi minus 1. I know this is less than epsilon, right? Therefore, keep this object, okay? Yeah, add and subtract. You understand this? So, integral a to b f d alpha minus summation f of ti alpha prime of ti into xi minus 1 plus add and subtract f of ti alpha prime ti xi minus 1 minus summation f of ti alpha prime si into xi minus xi minus 1. Are you following? Yes. Yeah. So this object is going to be this. Yeah, this minus this I added and subtracted and added. Okay. Therefore, that's going to be less than or equal to this plus modulus of this object. Are you following? Yes. This I know is less than epsilon. This is by my choice of thing. Because the moment you gave me epsilon, what did I do? I chose a partition P so that for all partitions Q finer than P, S of F Q T alpha and this integral is less than epsilon. That's how I chose. Do you understand? Yeah. Therefore, this object is less than epsilon, so I only have to do this. But this is a trivial job. What is this? This is same as less than or equal to modulus f of ti into modulus alpha prime ti minus alpha prime si into modulus, I don't write because it's in a positive anyway, this. Yeah. Now are you happy? Now you know what to do. Remember, what is our hypothesis about alpha? Alpha dash is continuous. Therefore, it's uniformly continuous where on AB. Right? So if it's uniformly continuous on AB, then what do I know? I can make this less than epsilon provided Ti and Si sit in Xi minus 1 to Xi. Right? So what should I do? So given the original partition P, I choose a partition P1 so that, okay, something like B minus A by N, N into equal parts, that will be less than some delta. Given epsilon, okay, there is a delta so that alpha prime S minus alpha prime T is less than epsilon. You understand that? Whenever mod S minus T is less than delta, alpha prime S minus alpha prime T is less than epsilon. Yeah. So choose a partition P1 subdivided into N, subdivide the interval AB into N subinterval each of equal length, namely the sum is B minus A by N. Right? And what do I want? B minus A by N must be less than delta. Therefore, my SI and T, S and T will be somewhere here. SI and TI. Their distance will be less than this. You understand that? Now, what should I do? So, I should choose a partition Q which is finer than P union P1. Yeah, for any partition is true. Therefore, any partition Q which is finer than P union P1, what will I have? I will have this will be less than epsilon and F is bounded by M and this XI minus S. So I will have this object so this will be less than equal to M into epsilon to summation XI minus 1 this is equal to M into B minus A into epsilon. You understand? Therefore, what I have shown? Integral A to B F D alpha minus summation F of Ti alpha prime Ti into Xi minus 1. This is S F alpha prime Q T. Okay? This in modulus is less than epsilon times 1 plus M into B minus A. What are this Q? Okay, I already had a partition P. Now what I can do? I can choose any partition. Maybe I can even choose, don't take P, to choose a partition P1 which is finer than P and such that the length of the subintervals is less than delta. Therefore, I can choose any Q which is finer than P1. Are you following? I'm simply simplifying. I just thought about in the proof, but if I want to write it, I can even simplify. What? How did I simplify? Choose a partition P with what property? This fellow is less than okay, this integral minus sf alpha t alpha sf q t alpha is less than epsilon for all q finer than p. Okay, right. Now what do I do? I wanted to estimate mod alpha dash sti minus alpha dash si. Where do they belong to? They belong to xi minus 1 to xi. So what do I want? Uniform continuity. Therefore I want the length of this sub interval should be less than delta. So what will I do? I start with the partition p1, which is finer than p, right? And the length of any sub interval is less than delta. Can I do that? I just have to put some more nodes in between so that the length becomes smaller, right? Take p, add some more nodes so that the length becomes smaller, length of the sub intervals becomes smaller. You understand that? Okay, therefore this p1 is true. Therefore if I take any q which is finer than this p1, what I have shown this, because that q will be finer than p1 and p1 is finer than p, therefore this result will be true. Are you following? Okay, please go through. Okay, pause, review, proceed. Okay, as you can see, throughout my lectures I tried to think and then write a proof rather than give a textbook proof. That would mean I should remember or I should have notes. I don't want to do that. Okay, but some of you, if you are worried about exam writing etc., you may not like this. But my suggestion would be, even if you don't go through this, it will make you understand the proof very well if you go through your class notes or a textbook or my own notes where textbook proofs are given. You will understand, you will also find it easier to remember. Okay, finally, if you want to remember so that you can write well and get good grades, even this will help. Okay, it will also help you to think how to solve problems. Okay, so we have come to the end of the course on Riemann integration. I hope all of you enjoyed. Okay, if you really appreciated my work, please leave your comments. Okay, that will motivate me to come up with another series. Okay, take care, all the best. Thank you.